When did you become aware of Dr. Ambedkar? And do you think you had an impression of his significance at that time? Did you feel ever moved to meet him? Yeah. And did you feel that such a meeting would carry any significance to you?
I must have heard about Dr. Ambedkar either in 1950 or 1949. At that time I didn't read the newspapers, but I think I knew that there was a big debate going on in the Indian Parliament about the Hindu Code Bill. And I knew that someone called Dr. Ambedkar was involved with that. But then later in 1950 itself, I read an article that he had written. And I think it was called the Buddha and the Future of His Religion. So I wrote to him. I was at that time in Kalimpong. And I'd started the Young Men's Buddhist Association. So I wrote to him telling him that. And I think I also sent a copy of the little magazine I was publishing. So I got a reply from him, written in his own hand. I still have that letter. And he said he was very glad, you know, that I was carrying on those sort of activities in Kanipong, and he was very encouraging. But I don't think at that time I had much idea about his position, especially his position with regard to the Dalit community.
So moving more further about Ambedkar, Bhante, and we heard Dr. Ambedkar was very strict and always to the point, and very forceful and fearless in character. You describe in Ambedkar and Buddhism, Bhante, about him that it was a great black storm cloud that might discharge thunder and lightning at any minute. So what was your impression of him, Bhante?
Well, that was my impression, yes. Because he didn't smile. And I noticed, you know, the first time I met him, I was just waiting to talk to him, and I noticed how he was reacting with the people who came to see him. There was, well, there must have been seven or eight people in a group came to see him, and he received them. But he wasn't smiling. He still looked very grim. And they tried to put garlands, marigold garlands, over his head, but he just pushed them aside like that. He didn't seem particularly pleased. In fact, he may have been frowning a little. So he did give an impression of being a rather stern, grim sort of person.
And could you say more about his second and third meeting with you, Bhante?
The second, my second meeting with him took place at Siddharth College in his room. At that time his wife, his second wife, was with him. And he was sitting behind the desk. So when I entered, he said, "Oh, I'm sorry, I can't get up to receive you. I've got very bad arthritis in my legs." So I thought from that, well, he may be stern and grim, but he's basically a very polite man. That was my impression. And so then we had some talk. And I think it must have been on that occasion, yes, it was on that occasion, he asked me if I would be ready to give a talk or give a lecture to some of his followers. So I said, yes, I'd be very happy to do that. And so he arranged for me to give a talk.
And when you met him last time, Bhante, after his conversion, I think, of. And he was, you were taking some delegates to him in Alipur Road, Delhi.
Yes, that was in 1956, at the time of the Buddha Jayanti.
Yes.
So I was on pilgrimage with a number of other Buddhists from North East India.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to meet him, taking all of them with me.
Mm-hmm.
Most of them didn't understand any English.
Mm.
So discussion was mainly between me and Dr. Ambedkar.
Mm.
And he clearly was very ill at that time.
Yes.
And it was a very hot day, and he was wearing a solar topi.
Mm-hmm.
And Mrs. Ambedkar was there. She was very anxious that he was talking too much. It wasn't good for his health, but he went on talking.
Mm-hmm.
And he expressed his fears, you know, for the Buddhist movement in India.
Mm-hmm.
He was very aware of the obstacles which it faced.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How do you see that change, Bhante, from your first meeting where he was very strict and forceful man, and his last meeting when he was becoming emotional and I was saying in a flow that so much is to be done, and you're describing that he wanted to sort of shoulder some of his weight of his responsibility to me. How would that feel to you, Bhante?
Well, first of all, I could see there was a very big change in his physical condition. First time I met him, he seemed strong and healthy. Though he may have had some illness, I don't know, but he seemed strong and healthy. And the second time, he clearly was an ill man. And the third time I met him, he was very ill. And therefore, you know, when a couple of months later I heard that he'd died, I was not surprised at all.
And you were present, Bhante, at Kasturchand Park on 6 December 1956. The day when Dr. Ambedkar passed away.
Yes, I was.
And you were describing, Bhante, that you could feel about the crowd, there is some hung and enormous presence there. So can you say something more about the mood of that day and how did you feel when you listened that he's passed away?
I'll go back a little bit. I was in Bombay, staying with friends, with a Parsi friend of mine, and I got a very strong feeling I must go to Nagpur. It wasn't a rational idea, it was that I must go to Nagpur, but my Parsi friends were urging me not to go. They thought that I shouldn't go at that time, and if I did go, something bad would happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, no, I have this strong urge, you know, to go to Nagpur. I didn't know why I had that urge, but I had it. So I acted on it. I went straight to Nagpur. And I was staying in the house of an old friend of mine, advocate Kulkarni. And just half an hour after I arrived, someone came from Sitabaldi to say that the news had arrived that Babaseb was dead. And he said that all people were in a state of shock and confusion. So would I come and speak to them? There was a big crowd, it seems, outside the Bharatiya Bodha Mahasabha's office in Sitabaldi. So I said, well, if there's such a large crowd, there needs to be some proper arrangements. You better arrange for a loudspeaker and all that. And then I will speak to people. So arrangements were made for a meeting in Kasturchand Park. And I went along there in the evening, and it was quite dark then. And I saw these streams of people coming from all directions, converging on the Kasturchand Park, and they were all carrying lighted candles. So there was a stream of people with lighted candles coming from all directions and gathering in Kasturchand Park. and they were completely silent. Hmm? Just completely silent. And as you know, in India, when you get a big crowd together, you don't often get complete silence.
Mm-hmm.
But it was completely silent. And then, the meeting began, the Shok Sabha, and they'd been able to arrange for a loudspeaker, but they hadn't been able to arrange for much else.
Mm-hmm.
And there were several speakers, but the speakers were so overcome by emotion that after speaking just for a few minutes, they broke down. They couldn't carry on. They just were crying. And so many people in the audience were also crying, all shedding tears.
Mm-hmm.
So two or three speakers, you know, tried in that way. And of course, then it came to my turn. So I felt quite moved by all that.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought, well, no, I've got to stay collected. I've got to speak something.
Mm-hmm.
No use me just shedding tears. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And there was no stage, so I had to stand up on a rickshaw.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? And the microphone was held in front
mm-hmm.
of me.
Mm-hmm.
So I spoke.
Mm-hmm.
And the gist of what I said was, I mean, Dr. Ambedkar may be dead. That is very sad. That's very unhappy. But we have to carry on with his work.
Mm-hmm.
So the spirit of Dr. Ambedkar is not dead. Hmm? And his work must continue. So people told me afterwards that they'd all been very encouraged by that.
Mm.
And some people even said mm. that on that day, with that speech, I had saved the Dharma for Nagpur. Hmm? This mm. is what they said.
Mm-hmm.
But then I must also say that while I was giving my talk, I felt as though it's very difficult to explain. I felt definitely as though, in a way, Dr. Ambedkar was there.
Hmm? Mm.
But a very great big Dr. Ambedkar, a very great big sort of Ambedkar consciousness, sort of hovering over the meeting.
Mm.
That's the sort of feeling, the sort of experience that I had, quite definitely.
Mm.
So I stayed in Nagpur for 4 or 5 days,
mm-hmm.
and I gave many talks. I tried to get around to all the localities. I must have given about 35 talks.
Yeah.
And in every locality I gave the same message,
mm-hmm.
that Dr. Ambedkar is dead, but his work must carry on. Hmm?
Mm-hmm.
People must fulfill his legacy.
Mm.
That was the message I gave.
Mm. Yeah. So I could tell you something more about the account of his first meeting, Bhante.
Yes, well, that first meeting took place in Rajgir, Dr. Ambedkar's residence in Dadar. And I was there sort of waiting my turn to talk to him, as I've mentioned a little earlier. And I was a bhikkhu then, of course, and wearing my yellow robe.
Hmm? Mm-hmm.
So, as soon as we had exchanged greetings, Dr. Ambedkar said, in an almost belligerent sort of way,
mm-hmm.
Why has your Maha Bodhi Society got a Brahmin for its president? So I said, this is not my Maha Bodhi Society at all. I said, I don't belong to it, and one of the reasons I don't belong to it is that it's got a Brahmin for its president.
Yeah.
But I do cooperate with it, and I hope that one day it will have a Buddhist for a president. And actually, some years later, the Maharaj Kumar of Sikkim was elected as president, with some help from me, I must say. But when he was elected, some of the Hindus connected with the Maha Bodhi Society said, oh, these Buddhists are very narrow-minded. They want to have a Buddhist as president of my Buddhist society. So I was quite astonished by that, that they should think it narrow-minded. Huh? That after two Brahmin Hindu presidents, we couldn't have, you know, a Buddhist president without being narrow-minded and sectarian.
Yeah, after that, what happened, Bhante?
Well, after that, Dr. Ambedkar became, I won't say he became more amicable, but he lost his belligerent look. I can't remember what other conversation we had. I don't think I stayed very long because I could see that he was busy and there were a lot of people waiting to see him. But anyway, I had made the contact, established the contact, and a few years later, you know, when I was in Bombay, I made arrangements to see him at Siddharth College, as I've related.
So, Bhante, in your view, what do you feel that the significance of conversion and its impact has on Indian society and culture?
Well, I well remember the response of many Hindus at the time, because I had many Hindu friends, and there was a variety of responses. A few said, it's good that these people have converted to Buddhism because they couldn't really have risen socially in any other way. A few did admit that. But many other Hindus were outraged. They were really upset, even angry. That who are these people to reject our glorious Hindu heritage? How dare they do it? Huh? That was their reaction. And others were afraid from a political point of view. They felt that if the untouchables converted to Buddhism, there would be fewer Hindus, and that would have some political implications. But a few others said, well, at least they haven't become Muslims. Some said that. But on the whole, the whole Hindu community was quite disturbed by the conversions. That was very clear.
And how does it help, Bhante, to emancipate the ex-untouchables? Because it's a quite significant phenomena happened in the modern history of India with the embracing of Buddhism by Dr. Ambedkar.
Well, it's well known nowadays that in Maharashtra, those Dalits who converted to Buddhism through their faith in Dr. Ambedkar, 40, 50, 60 years later, are much better off in every way. They're better off economically, better off socially, educationally, and of course they have the Dharma. And what could be a greater gain than that? So I think it's generally recognized that the movement of mass conversion was a great success, not just from the religious point of view, but from the social and economic and educational point of view as well. So it was a very great achievement, and that's why we speak of the Dharma revolution.
And have you ever feel, Bhante, that you miss this great event of conversion, and you have any regrets now about having missed it? Because what difference would it have made to our movement if you have been there?
I don't think it would really have made any difference at all. I think what is important is that I was there in Nagpur on the day that Dr. Ambedkar died. I think that is the important thing, so far as my own relationship with Dr. Ambedkar's mass conversion movement is concerned. I was there, you know, at the right time when I was really needed. So I don't have too many regrets about not being there at the time of the original mass conversion.
And Bhante, you were in India from after conversion, after 1956 up to 64. So were you able to contribute after Ambedkar's death in his conversion movement? And what else did you do during your stay in India, especially from 56 to 64?
Well, I was then based in Kalimpong. But I divided my time between Kalimpong, where I studied the Dharma, practiced meditation, and wrote books, and my lecture and preaching tours in the plains. And my lecture tours and preaching tours were mainly among, you know, Dr. Ambedkar's followers, because they had converted to the Dharma, converted to Buddhism, originally out of faith in Dr. Ambedkar, without knowing, in many cases, very much about Buddhism at all. So I took it upon myself to give as many talks, as many lectures as I possibly could, wherever I went. And I think I visited in every state in India, except Kashmir, every state. And in every state I gave talks, lectures on Buddhism. But I had three towns, three cities where I sort of, in a way, concentrated my activities. One of course was Nagpur, one was Bombay, and one was Pune. And there I built up a very strong connection with the local Dalit, or now Buddhist, community. And I must have given hundreds, of, maybe even thousands of lectures. And I was concerned with the fundamental principles of the Dharma. And lectures were important because so many of the people were illiterate. They couldn't read books on Buddhism. So it was only from live talks, live lectures, that they could get their information about the Dharma. And I found that they were very, very keen indeed to hear and to learn about the Dharma. So I used to talk about the three jewels, about the five precepts, about meditation, about the three lakshanas, about the four noble truths, noble eightfold path, and in some places, you know, where I developed a sort of regular audience, I was also able to talk about more philosophical things, because I very quickly realized that because people were illiterate, it didn't mean that they were not intelligent. Even an illiterate person can be very intelligent. So there were, if even quite deep aspects of the Dharma were explained to them in simple language, they could understand. So that was how I spent many, many, many months touring around. But also, of course, there was another side to it. I had to remove certain misunderstandings about Buddhism, or certain wrong beliefs and practices, which were being carried over from the days when the new Buddhists were Hindus. There were, for instance, I used to talk a lot about the evil of the dowry system. That is to say, you know, the system whereby the father of the girl has to pay money to the bridegroom or his family. And of course many people used to get into debt and borrow money so that they could pay the dowry. And sometimes the debt was handed on from one generation to another. and the family never became free from it.
Mm.
So I spoke very strongly against dowry system. I also spoke very strongly against spending too much money on the wedding ceremony. Because there again, the father of the bride would have to borrow money in order to feed 400, 500 people, when perhaps he couldn't really afford to feed more than 10 or 12. But for the sake of so-called prestige, he had to feed more. So I spoke against that. And also in some places, especially in some out-of-the-way villages, I found that people were still practicing animal sacrifice. That is to say, usually when someone became sick, then there was a belief, well, there's some bad goddess is responsible, we have to kill at least a chicken or maybe a goat even. So I had to speak about that and say that, well, animal sacrifice is not part of Buddhism, it's against the Buddha's teaching. So there were those evils which were still, you know, current among the new Buddhists that also I felt it necessary to deal with.